This next thing we're gonna do is on Bob Dylan's bootleg series called After the Show, Please Buy My Book Over There.
I don't know that one.
Yeah, it's a rarity. It's a rare one. My friends, the first time I saw Dylan, he was opening for the Dead. This journalist, without a noteworthy publication or even an official assignment, ticketless, broke, and 17, just able to be on the outside looking in, just spitting distance from this American airfield turned outdoor concert hall. So I climbed a tree that was pinned to the fence that was about halfway back from center stage. And there I perched, like an 8-year-old, in a sport, but with electricity. Yes, kind of like thanks to an extension cord plugged into a nearby neighbor's house that powered a tiny radio that at midnight could pick up a Detroit station. Playing Motown and R&B, maybe a few cuss words or street poetry. Cause the DJ, he sounded like a smooth criminal on a boulevard that you just had to get to. Or maybe I was up there like an old man on Desolation's Peak, on lookout for signs of smoke and fire. And up there in the branches, the old man is caught by the eyes of an eagle who watches him like he too was a wild beast, part of that gray sky, helpless tribe. Now that was the first time I saw Dylan. After a set, I climbed down the tree because the hippies in the woods by the hundreds had charged the fence and knocked it down. So I easily walked over the metal structure that was lying on the grass, like the hippies of the MTV generation. Or even those that were left over from Hunter S. Thompson's famous San Francisco flood. You know that gigantic Goliath wave that swallowed the Bohemian underbelly whole? They were unarmed without a slingshot in their grasp. So Rolling Stone ran off to the Big Apple to cash in on New Jerusalem's demise. With a fistful of receipts, saying that the cello move was gonna push underground music into the forefront. But the truth was they had a fistful of receipts and divorced the earthquake that enabled that subculture moment in history. They wrote it off as a business expense. They got a blonde with big tits. They got an office with a view. And then they courted corporate shit bands. Kind of like the Cult after renovations. Underwear on streetlight poles, double fisting life. And my friends, now we're left with six decades of Marilyn Monroe understudies that want the same fate. They mistook that dumb as doorknob gaze as rock and roll instead of the comedic stick she was meaning it to be. Now we're left Amy Winehouse, smashed, bottleneck, self-destruction blues. Once again, unarmed for such a wild ride.
Hey, come on,
inside the American airfield, I wasn't looking for the kids that I came with daddy's car, tickets, pockets full of money, and a little bit of weed. But I found them anyway. And that beautiful other world. So destiny put its perfect breeze for the day away, for destiny's turn to speak. It appeared in that magic curtain once more, late in the evening, in a small tornado cloud of dust. As I walk through the apocalyptic temple, the LSD outskirts of society sleepover. Self-proclaimed food, bead, and drug sellers, and those cardboard pencil shrines to Janis, Chipping, Cobain, and Hendrix. I weaved through it all invisible at 17. I was like a black and white Scrooge with a ghost of what's to come. Now, many years later, 6 months back to be exact, I discovered Jerry Garcia singing bluegrass. I was on a 401 interstate date. The driver was a beautiful woman. Professional dancer. Now she doesn't travel the world. She's a mother of two. But I'm here to fucking tell you, her legs and ass were in perfect form. And I say this with fucking authority. Like I was the artistic director of the Winnipeg Ballet. Perfect form. With Maggie's Farm Concerto. And I close with a savage curtsy. The middle was just electricity and smoke signals. I finally made it to that boulevard. And I felt the eyes of an eagle on my back, like the eyes of a hawk from outside the window in a tree of the Black Sheep Inn. Its nest made of discarded dreadlocks and Dylan's tambourine. That night in the hotel, the door was ajar, and that half-howl Ginsberg moon through the tarantula branches of the sidewalk trees. My friends, Ginsberg called him a blues man. times, always for free, and always without a noteworthy publication or an official assignment.
But when the man from Minnesota is your northern star,
your feet are safely planted for such a wild ride.